Good morning, everyone, and lovely to see you, and welcome to our service of worship. Just a couple of announcements. You may be aware of the various restrictions that have been recently lifted regarding COVID-19. PCI, having taken advice from the leading experts, are instructing churches to maintain the wearing of masks during worship and to observe the 2 metre distancing. Further relaxation of the rules is due next month, but their implementation will be at the discretion of individual Kirk sessions. So whenever we hear exactly what they're suggesting, then we will make the decision accordingly. The other announcement is just to thank Ian for organising the outing yesterday to Let's Go Hydro. All who went seemed to enjoy themselves, and despite the weather forecast, it actually stayed dry for them. Now, that sounds a wee bit Irish, doesn't it? They're going to get wet at Let's Go Hydro, but it was dry for them to do it. But for those who were standing on the sidelines watching, it was great that they got a dry day. It wasn't so dry here yet, if you remember. But thank you to Ian for organising that outing. We gather as church family in the name of our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ. God, our Heavenly Father, has revealed his great love for us in the person of his beloved Son. Jesus has promised to be in our midst when we meet in his name. By the enabling power of the Holy Spirit, we are made conscious of the presence of God. Therefore, may we lift up our voices in praise of his name. May we bow in humble adoration in the presence of the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. May we submit to the will of God for our lives and live in the light of his glory. So let us worship God. We will use the words of Psalm 24 as a responsive reading as we begin our service. I will read the words in white type and ask you to respond with the words in yellow type. Hear the words of Psalm 24. The earth is the Lord's, and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. For he founded it on the seas and established it on the waters. Who may ascend the mountain of the Lord? Who may stand in his holy place? The one who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not trust in an idol or swear by a false god. They will receive blessing from the Lord and vindication from God their Saviour. Such is the generation of those who seek him, who seek your face, God of Jacob. Lift up your heads, you gates. Be lifted up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, you gates. Lift them up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is he, this King of glory? The Lord Almighty, he is the King of glory. We join in praise as we stand to sing, Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Here I am to worship.
You see that it's hard to do.
Let's come to God in prayer. Let us pray. Almighty God, King of creation, Lord of the universe, maker of heaven and earth, by whose hand the galaxies came into being, by whose word the darkness and light were separated and given lights to distinguish their measure. Lord God, you spoke and the mountains were formed, the seasons were determined, and the land gave forth its crops. By your matchless power, the animals and birds were given their distinct features, and by their particular nature, many migrate and settle. Father God, we, as part of your creation, yet made especially in your own image, should enjoy the knowledge of your abiding presence each day, and therefore rejoice. But Lord, we are fully aware of that which has marred the fellowship we ought to have with you, the sin that so easily ensnares us and drives a wedge between us. The dark world of sin blocks that close relationship with you we so desperately need. We therefore come and confess our sin so that we may be healed, forgiven, and restored. So, Lord Jesus, Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Hear the words of repentance we offer today that come from penitent hearts. Refresh us, renew us, and give us a willing spirit to strive to honor you in all we do. Empowering Holy Spirit, fill us with the knowledge of God's will, and then strengthen us for the tasks ahead. May our witness be consistent, our mouths filled with words of truth, and our hearts controlled by the compassion of the love of Christ. Merciful and ever-living God, hear our prayer as we seek to glorify you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And this we ask through Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray as we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Let us again praise God as we sing that lovely song, This is Amazing Grace.
The nations.
Let us join again in prayer as we bring our prayers for others. Let us pray. Father God, we have just been singing about your greatness. We've been singing about the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. We have been singing about all that you have done for us in Christ. And we thank and praise you that day by day we enjoy your blessing. There are so many things that we take for granted. Our health and our strength, our friends and our family. But Lord, they're all blessings from you. There is food in our cupboards. There are clothes on our backs. We've beds on which to sleep. Lord, we're so thankful. And yet we are thinking today of those who are not enjoying those blessings. We think particularly of those who are living in lands where there has been the wildfires. We think of Turkey. We think of Greece. We think of Italy. We think of Spain and many other countries that maybe we haven't even heard about, where the weather has been so hot and the wind so strong that when a fire catches, it spreads. Lord, we think of those who have been sitting out on the boats on the sea, watching their homes go up in flames. Their livelihoods have been gone. Lord, we pray for them. We pray for the governments of those countries who are trying to deal with these catastrophes. We begin to take on board what the experts and the scientists are saying, that a lot of this is our fault. The wonderful world that you have given us, we have spoilt. We have plundered. We have not taken into consideration the effect on nature. And so we do pray for world governments as they will soon be discussing what can be done about climate change and the effects that it's having in those in other lands, particularly those of poorer lands where they don't have the facilities and they don't have the resources that we have, and where a slight change in temperature will affect their whole livelihoods and their well-being. Lord, grant wisdom. Grant humility. And help us to see a way forward so that the generations that yet are to come will have a world in which they can live in peace and in harmony. Father, we think too of the diseases that are around the world. And we think particularly of COVID-19 and how it has affected so many lands. And we think of the land of Brazil and how it has devastated the population there. And yet so many people are ignoring that it exists. Lord, we pray again for the world, that they will see that we are now so close one to the other. We're almost a global village, and we ought to look out for one another. And so we pray for agencies that are bringing help to these lands. We pray that there will be a sharing of the vaccine. We pray for those who are grieving today because they've lost loved ones through COVID or other diseases or indeed disasters. Bring that comfort that only you can bring. Surround them with your everlasting arms and uphold them day by day. Father, we pray for our own community and indeed our own church family and those who need your healing touch this day. Bring strength to limb, that healing to both body and mind. As we thank you for those who have the skills to bring healing to the body,
those who have studied, those who are surgeons, those who are GPs, nurses, care assistants, all those who are bringing that comfort and your healing touch. Lord, you are the great physician, and at your word you can bring that healing. Usually it is through the means of medicine, but at times, oh God, you work in miracle. So give us that faith to believe. And then, Lord, the greatest need of the world is to hear your gospel. And so we pray for those who are bringing it to those in other lands and indeed are spreading the good news here at home. We thank you for the promise that whenever your word is shared and preached, that will never return unto you void, but will accomplish that for which you sent it. And so we do pray, Lord, that there will be a harvest of souls, that people hearing the word of God and responding to it will find salvation in Christ. So, Lord, all these prayers we offer to you, asking that you will hear us and answer us, thanking you for all the promises that you have given us in your word, as we believe in your power and your strength and your perfect will. And all these we bring through Christ, our Redeemer. Amen. Let me take you back over a century ago to a very small village in the Clayton County of northeast Iowa, where a man called John Froelich invented a piece of machinery. It was later to be called a tractor. It was the first successful petrol engine that could maneuver forwards and backwards, the most rudimentary functions of modern engines. I know in the last couple of years, we've heard of the development of the tractor by people like Harry Ferguson and Henry Ford and many others. Indeed, my earliest experience of driving was on a wee grey Fergie. I try to imagine the discussion in a farmstead in those days, when a son of a farmer is trying to persuade his dad to invest in one of these new contraptions. I can hear the dad say, "Ah, all these new inventions. What's wrong with the horse? I ploughed with it for years, and my father before that. Why change?" Or maybe in more recent times, a young lad has been to agricultural college and comes home with all these new ideas of farming. The dad, or more so granddad, is not very impressed and is very reticent to adopt any of these newfangled ways. As we return to our series on questions people ask the Lord Jesus, in our reading today, we find the old schoolers, namely the Pharisees, not being very impressed with this new teaching coming from the new kid on the block, namely Jesus of Nazareth. And so we hear them quiz him on his credentials. So let's turn to John chapter 8, and we'll read from verse 12 through to verse 30. So let us hear God's word.
When Jesus spoke again to the people, he said, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." The Pharisees challenged him. "Here you are, appearing as your own witness. Your testimony is not valid." Jesus answered, "Even if I testify on my own behalf, my testimony is valid. For I know where I came from and where I am going. But you've no idea where I came from or where I'm going. You judge by human standards. I pass judgment on no one. But if I do judge, my decisions are true, because I am not alone. I stand with the Father who sent me. In your own law it is written that the testimony of two witnesses is true. I am one who testifies for myself. My other witness is the Father who sent me. Then they asked him, "Where is your Father?" "You do not know me or my Father," Jesus replied. "If you knew me, you would know my Father also." He spoke these words while teaching in the temple courts, near the place where the offerings were put. Yet no one seized him, because his hour had not yet come. Once more Jesus said to them, "I am going away, and you will look for me, and you will die in your sin. Where I go, you cannot come." This made the Jews ask, "Will he kill himself? Is that why he says, 'Where I go, you cannot come'?" But he continued, "You are from below. I am from above. You are of this world. I am not of this world. I told you that you would die in your sins if you do not believe that I am he. You will indeed die in your sins." "Who are you?" they asked. "Just what I have been telling you from the beginning," Jesus replied. "I have much to say in judgment of you, but he who sent me is trustworthy, and what I have heard from him, I tell the world." They did not understand what he was telling them about his Father. So Jesus said, "When you have lifted up the Son of Man, then you will know that I am he, and that I do nothing on my own, but speak just what the Father has taught me. The one who sent me is with me. He has not left me alone, for I always do what pleases him." Even as he spoke, many believed in him. We just praise God for his word. Amen.
At the end of chapter 7, we have a very interesting scene. The Pharisees are getting frustrated because they want to silence Jesus. They want to bring him in for questioning. Yet many are following him and giving attention to his teaching. And so there's a growing support for Jesus. Even the up to now secret follower of Jesus, Nicodemus, one of their own, speaks in defense of Jesus. This maddens the other Pharisees. It seems nobody is willing to do much about this imposter, Jesus. So in the meantime, they will have to suffice with challenging him whenever they get an opportunity. We may understand a little of their annoyance. Listen to Jesus, the claims Jesus makes. Verse 12 of chapter 8 reads thus, "When Jesus spoke again to the people, he said, 'I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life.'" The timing of Jesus' claim could not be of little consequence, as this was around the time of the Feast of Tabernacles, a time when the Jewish people remembered the wandering in the desert by the children of Israel, a time when they were dependent upon the guiding light of God in the form of a pillar of cloud by day and pillar of fire by night. What was Jesus getting at when he made this claim? Was he identifying himself with God? We have a challenge coming from the Pharisees. "Here you are, appearing as your own witness. Your testimony is not valid." What they were saying was, "You're just boasting, and no one can confirm your testimony, so it cannot be true." Jesus' reply is most certainly confusing to his listeners and creates even more uneasiness. He refutes their claim. He, in essence, says, "You don't understand my origin or my destiny." Jesus certainly knows from whence he came and is confident in the knowledge of where he's heading. When he refers to the Father,
He really puts the cat among the pigeons. They really don't have a clue. Jesus goes on to claim that the Father has sent him into the world, and therefore he does have someone who can verify his claims. He then plays them at a familiar game they play, namely quoting the law. He quotes to them from the Old Testament. You can find it in Deuteronomy chapter 17, verse 6. On the testimony of two or three witnesses, a person is to be put to death, but no one is to be put to death on the testimony of only one witness. He goes on to say, I am one who testifies for myself. My other witness is the Father who sent me. They begin to detect that Jesus is referring to Yahweh as his Father when he makes that comment. Now, that's going too far. Again, they try to act smart and they ask a question, where is your Father? As much as to say, we cannot see him. So until you get him, we won't believe a word you say. Surely they're on dangerous grounds here. Not only are they rejecting the Lord Jesus, but are voicing doubts about God the Father's existence. Yes, Jesus is making some serious claims. But we also find the conclusions Jesus reaches. Look at how he replies to their question. You do not know me or my Father, Jesus replied. If you knew me, you would know my Father also. Wow, that's a stinging statement. He then adds layer upon layer. I am going away and you will look for me. And you will die in your sin. Where I go, you cannot come. Neither at completely at a loss. What's he saying now? Dying in their sin? Going to somewhere they cannot go? In their confusion and contempt, they sneer at him and suggest, is he going to kill himself? What Jesus was actually saying is that he was going away, a reference to him returning to his Father in heaven. They will indeed look for him, but not find him. They will die in their sin and as a result cannot be with Christ. He continues, you are from below, I am from above. You're of this world, I am not of this world. I told you that you would die in your sins. If you do not believe that I am he, you will die, indeed die in your sins. It's obvious that they haven't got the message. Jesus states clearly that they're on a different plane. He is from above, meaning heavenly, and they are of this world, sinful. And there is a correlation between not believing in Christ and dying in their sins. This is all too much for them. So they try to divert the attention away from themselves by believing that the best defense is attack. And thus we have another question. Who are you? They asked. Jesus' answer is a straightforward one. Just what I've been telling you from the beginning, or as it says in an earlier version of the NIV, just what I've been claiming all along. Basically, the Father has sent me into the world. He is a reliable witness who can verify my identity. He has sent me with a message, and I will tell the world. Have you ever been trying to explain something to someone, and they just don't seem to be able to get a handle on what you're saying? I know when I was teaching, there were times when no matter what angle I came at the subject, that there were those who were sitting with a blank look. It was exasperating at times. One may wonder if Jesus was getting exasperated at these Pharisees. John writes, they did not understand that he was telling them about his Father. How was Jesus going to get through to them and convince them of the validity of his identity and his message? Well, he will prove it, but not now. But still, he lets them know how it will happen. Here's how Eugene Peterson in the Message translates verses 28 and 29. When you raise up the Son of Man, then you will know who I am. That I'm not making this up, but speaking only what the Father taught me. The one who sent me stays with me. He doesn't abandon me. He sees how much joy I take in pleasing him. Jesus was predicting his crucifixion. He will have fulfilled the many prophecies of the Old Testament. Incidentally, the Son of Man is a phrase used in the Psalms, in Ezekiel, and in particular by Daniel the prophet. This would be a familiar phrase to the Pharisees. So all that would happen would prove without a doubt that Jesus and his message were authentic. While the Pharisees were being obstinate, hard-hearted, and dismissive of Jesus and his gospel, John finishes this little section of narrative with this sentence of what I call joy and encouragement. Even as he spoke, many put their faith in him. As we conclude, I want us to ponder briefly on the crises Jesus presents. And we'll do so by asking a few questions of ourselves. Do we take Jesus seriously? Or are we dismissing him as irrelevant, like the Pharisees in our reading today? In a world where everyone wants data and evidence, they're skeptical about anything new, and that has definitely been brought to the fore by the vaccination program. But do we do the same with Jesus? We want empirical evidence before taking his message seriously. Oh, we'll have faith in many human inventions, contraptions, and indeed philosophies. But when it comes to faith in Christ, that's somehow a different matter. And then, can we say that we understand what Jesus came to do? Sent from the Father to bring the gospel message, but also to be the gospel message. The message is indeed hard-hitting. It says we're in spiritual darkness. We are sinners. That is something from which we will always shy away. But there's another question. Have we accepted Christ as Savior and Lord? That his being lifted up upon the cross was the means of our salvation. In today's world, we are encouraged to be assertive and make our own way in the world, putting me first. We want to think of ourselves as self-sufficient. But when it comes to salvation, we're impotent. Christ is the only way. Here's another poignant question, and it's a hard-hitting question, but it's something I think we need, particularly in this modern world as we're facing pandemic and day by day we are faced with statistics. If you were to die today, would you die in your sins? Would you be eternally separated from the Lord Jesus, cast out into what the Bible describes as outer darkness? Or are you, praise God, one of the many who, in the words of verse 30, have put their faith in him? You have moved from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of the Son, S-O-N. You have the light of life, Christ himself living within you. You've been freed from sin's bondage and have the joy of being called a child of God. If you have, you need to become that ambassador for Christ. And on behalf of your Lord and Savior, you ought to be sharing the good news, encouraging others to come in saving faith to him. Will you do it? Amen. Let's pray. Father God, we we come to you and we thank you for Jesus. We thank you for the cross. We thank you for his message, but we thank you that he is the means of our salvation. May we rejoice in that fact. And may we live for you day by day, knowing that we have been freed from the bondage of sin and that we are living in that wonderful relationship, a living relationship with our God through Christ Jesus. Hear our prayer, for we pray in his name. Amen.
Our final hymn this morning is a wonderful old hymn written by Charles Wesley, which speaks of being freed from the dark dungeon of sin, being free in Christ. We sing together, "And can it be that I should gain an interest in the Saviour's blood?"
vastness divine. Behold, I approach the eternal throne and take the crown through Christ my own. Behold, I approach the eternal throne and claim the crown through Christ my own.
Be free in the love of Christ. Know and experience his presence day by day, and go to proclaim him both Lord and Saviour. Let us bless one another with the words of the grace. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.